Thank you very much, Dean Robertson, for this very generous introduction. I'm grateful to the University and the Faculty of Humanities, and specifically the Department for South Asian Languages and Civilization, for inviting me to give the Vivekananda lecture, following in the footsteps of my distinguished colleagues, first the late Chris Bailey, and second David Schulman. And as you said, I have given a Vivekananda lecture before. So this is my second Vivekananda lecture. In 1987, on my first trip to the US, at the moment that I thought I would never go here, I was invited by Professor Barney Cohn to give the Vivekananda Memorial Lecture. And I had recently defended my dissertation at the University of Utrecht, and I was usefully thrilled to give what I assumed to be an important named lecture. My sense of self-importance was quickly deflated when Professor Cohn told me that this was not an annual event, that he had acquired some funds to be spent on one Swami Vivekananda lecture, and that the funding source was somewhat obscure. He whispered, "A millionaire," but I'm not sure. He had a great sense of humor, and he may have thought that as a European I would be thrilled by such an instance of the American way of doing things. Again, as you know, or as some of you know, some frisson of mystery adheres to the Vivekananda lecture even today. From my personal perspective, indeed, things have come full circle, which gives me great delight, as if one is the beneficiary of occult forces. So thank you very much. There is an interesting disjuncture between my ethnographic experience of the Ramanandi techniques of the body, about which I spoke in my first Vivekananda lecture, and Vivekananda's elevation of yoga into the paramount form of Indian spirituality. I had seen yoga in Indian cities, practiced by urbanites, but hardly in Ayodhya in North India, where I had done my fieldwork. The Ramanandi monks who I studied were either tyagis, renouncers who focused on the internalization of fire, or rasiks who performed devotional worship by making themselves into female companions of the god. Both philosophical yoga and bodily hatha yoga had little to nothing to do with the monastic practices I encountered in Ayodhya. Although yoga has ancient roots in Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, it is not central to many Hindu traditions, even of Patanjali's time, and importantly, also not to those today. In other words, there is much more to Hinduism than Vivekananda's formulation of it. That is obviously not surprising, since Hinduism is a name for a huge number of local and regional traditions that are only partly integrated and hardly centralized. In that regard, it is very comparable to Taoism in China. Nationalism in general, but also in the case of Vivekananda, can be understood as an attempt to unify by abstraction and purification. At the same time, it derives its social energy from being always an unfinished project. It attempts to unify, but inevitably also diversifies and makes new distinctions and oppositions. The most obvious example of this is the partition of India and the continuing story of Hindu-Muslim antagonism. Swami Vivekananda's lecture in 1893 at the World Parliament of Religions here in Chicago can be seen as world historical in at least two ways. One, he connected his understanding of colonized India's Hindu traditions to a new cosmopolitan spirituality and claimed that India was the world's spiritual leader. Second, he connected this newly found cosmopolitan spirituality to nationalism. He was, in my view, the first one to do this, although many were to follow him. Vivekananda's formulation of Hindu spirituality was an attempt to nationalize Hinduism. This way of interpreting Vivekananda has, of course, been disputed by a number of scholars, including the late Tapan Ray Chaudhary, who argued that Vivekananda was not a nationalist, but a universalist, who recognized the fundamental unity of all religions. In Vivekananda's words, that are quoted by Ray Chaudhary, "Truth alone is my God, the entire world is my country," unquote. I would suggest, however, that there is not a necessary contradiction between cosmopolitanism and nationalism. Enlightened traditions of cosmopolitanism, most famously that of Kant, have obscured that every cosmopolitanism comes from somewhere. Vivekananda propagates a Hindu cosmopolitanism that is at the same time a Hindu nationalism. The very concept of spirituality as both universal and particularistic that emerges in America and Europe at the time makes this possible. His construction of yoga as India's spiritual gift to the world is indeed a thoroughly modern one. He only became a teacher of yoga during his visit to the US, where he was supported by wealthy American ladies in search of spirituality. That it was America that supported his turn to yoga as spirituality may not surprise those who have read Henri David Thoreau, who wrote in 1849, almost a half a century before Vivekananda's arrival in the US, quote, "To some extent and at rare intervals, even I am a yogi." I especially like that rare interval. What then is the concept of spirituality, and why would India be the spiritual leader of the world and not China, the other great civilization of Asia? Spirituality is not a concept that translates existing concepts that are already existing in Indian or Chinese traditions. It is a modern concept that emerges in the imperial interactions of the late 19th century. It connects the quest for contact with the spirits in the US, especially after the American Civil War, with the encounter with the religious traditions of the East. It also connects English antinomian traditions with a new anti-colonial universalism. And the major figure in all of this is Helena Blavatsky, better known as Madame Blavatsky, whom Gauri Viswanathan somewhat breathlessly sees as one of the most important countercultural figures in 19th century Europe. It is good to remember that when Blavatsky and Colonel Henry Alcott founded the Theosophical Society, it was named the Theosophical Society of the Arya Samaj. They tried to link up with Swami Dayanand's North Indian reform movement, the Arya Samaj, seeking Hindu authenticity for their new society. Dayanand Saraswati, however, found its theosophical ideas entirely opposite to his own attempts to create an archaic Hinduism based on his personal understandings of the Vedas, which were disputed by many others. Being a prolific polemicist, he wrote a pamphlet called Humbuggery of the Theosophists, lampooning them. Vivekananda also distanced himself from the esotericism of theosophy. He already had a master, Ramakrishna Paramahans, and did not need Blavatsky for secret communications with the superhuman. Masters of the universe residing in Tibet, where nobody could go, were a safer choice for the theosophist than really existing Indian gurus who had their own ideas. What is striking in theosophy is the move from existing religious beliefs and practices to a level of occult abstraction. In Euro-America, this was meant to get away from the authority structures of Christianity. But the theosophists definitely did not want to replace them by Indian authority structures. Archaic India, as the heartland of Hinduism and Buddhism, was clearly the chosen land for spirituality, but only on theosophical terms. In general, it was the archaic rather than the contemporary that was sought after. Archaic Egypt or Mesopotamia was also interesting as a source of occult wisdom, just like India. The archaic was obviously sought after by many, and not only theosophists. One may, for instance, recall Freud's fascination with Egypt. To an extent, this was a continuation of an interest in Gnosticism, but also a desire to be thoroughly modern and thus scientific was added to it. There's a real sense in which experiments with the self replaced the rituals of the church. The spiritualists regarded these experiments as scientific, but at the same time, they can be understood as critiques of rationality. So they see themselves as scientific, but still have an argument about rationality. Such critiques can also be found in Max Weber and Sigmund Freud, and later in the Frankfurter Schule. But occultists went much further in their critique of the ultimate authority of reason. As Alex Owen has argued, they posited a creative partnership of intuition and reason, pushing the boundaries of the real beyond anything that might be empirically verified by the non-initiate. In her Why I Became a Theosophist, Annie Besson put it like this, and I quote, "Whatever forces may be latent in the universe at large, or in man in particular, they are wholly natural, the superhuman. Yes, the supernatural, no." Unquote. I probably do not have to remind this audience that Annie Besant, the successor of Alcott as president of the Theosophical Society, had fulfilled the requirements for a Bachelor in Science from the University of London, but was refused the degree because of her radicalism, was a socialist activist, a feminist who fought for women's wages as well as for their right to birth control, actually the most important birth control pamphlet that was circulated by her in Britain, also going to the Netherlands, and played an enormous role in developing feminism in the Netherlands. And she was an anti-colonial activist who became the first female president of the Indian National Congress. She embodies the radical anti-church and anti-colonial modernism of the late 19th century that produced the global concept of spirituality. One might perhaps call it a re-enchantment of the secular age, although I don't know whether Charles Taylor would really accept it. What the so-called East offered was an embodied spirituality, and specifically techniques of the body, taught by handsome Indian men. Rejected by Dayanand and Vivekanand, Besant later found her guru in what she mistakenly thought to be a more manageable young man, named Krishnamurti, whom she wanted to make into the spiritual master of the universe. The immense cultural significance of spirituality in the West can be perhaps best gauged by looking at artistic creation, and especially the visual arts. Although we can also look at literature, but I think it's spectacular in visual arts. One of the formative experiences on his road to abstract painting that Vasily Kandinsky describes is his encounter with Monet's paintings of haystacks, and several of these haystacks are in the Art Institute of Chicago. And I quote, "And suddenly, for the first time, I saw an image. That it was a haystack, I learned from the catalogue. That I hadn't recognized it was painful for me. I also thought that the painter had no right to paint so unclearly. I experienced dimly that there was no object in this image, and noticed astonished and upset that the image did not only catch, but that it imprints itself indelibly in memory and floats always totally unexpected in final detail before one's eyes." Unquote. So from an art historical perspective, this could be understood as part of the internal development of art from impressionism to abstraction. Kandinsky, however, refers in his Über das Geistige in der Kunst, the spiritual in art, one of the most influential texts by an artist in the 20th century, to Madame Blavatsky. who in his words was, and I quote, the first person after a life of many years in India, a little bit exaggerated, to see a connection between these quote unquote savages and our quote unquote civilization. He used these scarecrows deliberately. According to Kandinsky, and I quote, the number is increasing of those men who put no trust in the methods of material science when it deals with questions which have to do with non-matter, or matter that is not accessible to our senses. Just as art is looking for help from the primitives, so these men are turning to half-forgotten times in order to get help from half-forgotten methods. However, these methods are still alive and in use among nations whom we, from the height of our knowledge, have been accustomed to regard with pity and scorn. The Theosophical Society consists of groups who seek to approach the problem of the spirit by way of inner knowledge. Their methods, in opposition to positivism, derive from an ancient wisdom which has been formulated with relative precision. Unquote. I cannot resist to mention that the other great pioneer of abstract art, Piet Mondrian, was also, of course, I'm also a nationalist, so I have to refer to my own culture, was also completely taken by Theosophy in his move to abstraction. His use of geometric form is directly inspired by his reading of Blavatsky's Isis Unveiled, a terrible text, in fact. In 1909, he became a member of the Theosophical Society, and on his membership card, one finds the signature of Annie Besant. Striking in Mondrian's thought is his belief in evolution, the aspiration to higher forms of consciousness, to the superhuman, which he found expressed in the teaching of Blavatsky and later Rudolf Steiner. It's perhaps interesting to note that although Vivekananda and Theosophy also deeply influenced Indian painting, it did not make this enormous leap into abstraction. Here, spirituality was found in the romantic depiction of Hindu traditions in styles derived from Mughal and Rajput painting. This is Bharat Mata by Abanindranath Tagore. One can find that in his work. He's a nephew of Rabindranath Tagore. And he became vice principal of the Calcutta School of Art under the patronage of the influential E.B. Havel. What we see here in the Indian painting is cosmopolitan spirituality, but with a nationalist difference. Nothing could be further away from Kandinsky and Mondrian than the Bengal School of Art, despite the huge influence of Theosophy on both. The famous art historian Ananda Kumaraswamy, who became the great promoter of Indian art and spirituality in the first half of the 20th century, brought art and nationalism explicitly together in his Essays in National Idealism and Art in Swadeshi of 1912. Kumaraswamy's interventions can also be read as an incipient Pan-Asianism. Following his predecessor as curator of Asian art at the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, the Japanese artist Kakuzo Okakura, 1862 to 1913, who opened his book The Ideals of the East of 1903 with the line, Asia is one. Okakura came to visit the Tagores in 1902 and befriended Margaret Noble, better known as Sister Nivedita, the disciple of Swami Vivekananda and a fervent proponent of Indian nationalist arts. The outbreak of the First World War is a major rupture that made many Asians look at their own traditions instead of the West. It did away with the alleged superiority of European culture and in fact showed the barbarity and materialism of Germany, Britain and France. After receiving the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1913, Rabindranath Tagore felt that Asia should assume the role of spiritual leader of the world. On the continuum between cosmopolitan and nationalist spirituality, he came to occupy the regional middle ground of Pan-Asianism. In 1916, he delivered a speech at Tokyo Imperial University titled the message of India to Japan, arguing that Asia had a spiritual mission in the world. He was enthusiastically greeted by large crowds. Japanese intellectuals, however, saw their warrior traditions as a central part of their spirituality. They rejected Tagore's and Gandhi's pleas for non-violence as signs of a defeated colonized nation. Pan-Asianism in Japan ultimately turned into an ideology of so-called liberation from Western colonialism under Japanese leadership in the so-called co-prosperity sphere. So it turns really into a totally different thing. This is still a dominant theme of the representation of history if you go, for example, to the museum attached to the Yasukuni Shrine in Tokyo. This is the way it is. The Japanese interventions in China are presented in Indonesia. In 1924, after Japan, Tagore went to China, and his reception here resembled that of Japan. First, large crowds that were curious to see this Asian Nobel Prize winner who looked like a sage, then skepticism by some intellectuals, and ultimately rejection and opposition, especially by communist activists. In short, there is a remarkable continuity from Vivekananda to Tagore, Gandhi, and even Nehru in claiming that India is the spiritual leader of the world. Western intellectuals and artists accepted this claim, but other Asians often rejected it. The acceptance of India's spiritual leadership in the West may have emerged from European scholarship's focus on the Indo-Aryan sources of European civilization. German Orientalists, sometimes in British employment, like Friedrich Max Müller, focused on the archaic textual traditions of India. The Romantic philosophers of Germany had long sought the wisdom of the East in India rather than in China. Wilhelm von Humboldt and others regarded Sanskrit as the purest of languages with a perfect grammar, while they saw Mandarin Chinese as hardly a language at all. China had broken off contacts with the West in 1721 when the Pope decided that Catholics should not accept the heavenly mandate of the Qing Emperor. This made, in effect, Catholicism into a banned heterodoxy, Shejiao. The Jesuits, who in the 17th century had informed Leibniz and others about Chinese systems of knowledge, were banned. And it was only after the Opium Wars in the mid-19th century that the connection with Western scholarship were re-established. India, on the other hand, was colonized, made part of the British Empire after the mutiny, while China was not colonized, although it was under the sway of multiple imperial forces. This difference is not only constitutional, but also linguistic. The modern Indian intelligentsia, like Vivekananda, had English as secondary and sometimes primary language. But the Chinese kept to their own language and learned often about Western knowledge only through Japanese translations. Most remarkable is the difference between Vivekananda's performance in the World Parliament of Religions and that of Pang Guangyu, the Chinese representative of Confucianism and first secretary of the Chinese legation in Washington. Pang gives the official view that Confucianism was not a religion, but a teaching, a jiao, a teaching of proper human relations in a hierarchy headed by the emperor and his officials. Pang argued that religion should not be translated as jiao, as teaching, but as Wu, as shamanism. So from a Confucian point of view, Christianity could be regarded as a form of shamanism. Now that's a pretty radical argument. I would have loved to see the faces at that time. He rejected the notion that all teachings were equal. Instead, he argued that some religions were dangerous superstitions that the state had to control. Well, Hinduism in Vivekananda's representation carried a message of universal toleration. Pang Guangyu's representation of Confucianism challenged the conceptualization of world religions that states Confucianism, Taoism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity as equal ethical messages to the world. He emphasized the centrality of the Qing state in adjudicating the place of religions in China. Although this authority was obviously at that very moment fundamentally challenged by the imperial powers who had forced the Qing to accept missionaries. Such a position is very different from Vivekananda's and other Indian leaders' rejection of the colonial state as the arbiter of religious difference. So while Pan Kuan Yew represented an orthodox statist interpretation of Confucianism, Kang Youw Wei, one of the most important reformist Confucians, argued in the same period that Confucianism should be made into a civil religion as the basis of a new Chinese state and a new Chinese nationalism. This was in some ways inspired by what was done in Japan with Shintoism. Most spectacularly, he started a campaign to destroy temples and replace them with schools, in which a national curriculum would be taught, existing of Western science and Confucian morality and ritual. It's important to see how different this is from a previous Confucian conception of the imperial mandate of heaven, supported by imperial ritual. He was then also put in prison. Despite the success of destroying temples, which continued under the later nationalist and communist regimes, Kang Youw Wei's civil religion never took hold of the Chinese imagination, except perhaps in the diaspora, especially among Chinese in Indonesia, Singapore, and Malaysia. One can find the spiritual sources of Chinese nationalism not in statist Confucianism, but in a whole different spectrum of ecstatic practices ranging from spirit procession to spirit writing. Here we have a Chinese tradition that resembles Western spiritism, but does not refer to cosmopolitan spirituality. Pan would have put some of these practices straight in the dangerous category of shamanism. And that was exactly how the first ethnographer of Chinese religion, the Dutchman Jacobus de Groot, interpreted them. Spirit writing, however, is ambiguous. Fuluan, holding the phoenix, or Fuji, holding the divination, are the words for spirit writing in Chinese. It's generally translating with holding the planchette, using Allan Kardec's invention of the little plank for spirit communication in mid-19th century French spiritism. So the connection, you can see that when you can use that French word for it as a translation, how much it resembles each other. Through spirit writing, morality books are composed, which give the audience moral instructions to lead a good life. This morality is in fact Confucian: benevolence, righteousness, propriety, and filial piety. In the second half of the 19th century, this genre was expanded from its exclusive circle of scholar literati to a much broader audience in spirit writing cults. And in Myths of Origins of the time, the circle of Confucius and his followers is seen as the first spirit writing cult. These spirit writing cults, with their strong public morality, could grow into large movements like Shentian Dao and its successor Iguan Dao in the earlier 20th century. Such movements were not passively moral, but actively martial. Some developed a millenarian content derived from the cyclical worldview of Buddhism, in which the current kalpa was seen as the last of a cycle that would be closed by the coming of the Maitreya Buddha. It is clear why Pan Kuan Yew, as representative of the imperial state in the World Parliament of Religions, feared such movements. After all, only a few decades before he gave his lecture, a millenarian movement influenced by Christianity, the Taiping, was crushed, leaving 30 million people dead and entire regions of southern China devastated. By comparison, the death toll of the American Civil War was less than 1 million. 30 million is a huge amount. The Boxer Uprising still had to happen. So millenarian movements as expression of religion were indeed seen as pretty dangerous. And these millenarian movements continued to have tens of millions of followers in the 1930s and 1940s. Only after 1949, the communists immediately targeted them and wiped them out with an incredible speed within a few years. I think this is because the communists themselves can be seen as millenarian. But their message had the backing of the state and therefore they had more persuasive power. The spirit writing movements were definitely political and offered a moral nationalism. But to what extent can they be understood within the narrative of cosmopolitan spirituality? They seem, from the face of it, eminently suited for the cosmopolitan discourse, since their methods look so much like spiritism. In fact, however, they do not refer to the spirituality of the West. So it's very different from Vivekananda's presentation, which is so American, in fact. The difference may lie in the fact that China had not been colonized. A brief comparison with Vietnam that was colonized by France may illustrate this point. South Chinese spirit writing cults have heavily influenced Vietnamese spirit writing. In Vietnam, in contrast to China, the linkage of spirit writing with cosmopolitan spirituality can be easily shown. For example, in Cao Dai, the third largest religion in Vietnam. This religion emerged in the 1920s. It was founded by a group of Taoist civil servants who engaged in spirit writing in the Xian Tian Dao, known as Ming Shu, revered master movements in Vietnam. The main text of this movement is a word-by-word transliteration from Mandarin into Vietnamese of Taoist texts that originated in the Xian Tian Dao in Guangdong, in Canton. The French translation that is used in the movement, however, is heavily influenced by Kardec spiritism, by theosophy, and by Catholicism. Victor Hugo, who practiced spiritism in the 1850s, has been included as a major saint in the Cao Dai pantheon. The Vietnamese spirit writing cults are basically southern Chinese, but framed by French spirituality, unlike the Chinese one. So it's really a real interesting contrast to see how the same thing works differently in Vietnam and in China. Going back to China, Buddhism is another source of Chinese spiritual nationalism. Late in his life, Liang Qichao, one of the most significant Chinese thinkers reflecting on the imperial encounter, concluded that the West was materialistic and the East was spiritual. And it is not surprising that he was Tagore's host on the latter's visit to China and that he defended Tagore against his communist critics. According to Liang, China's spirituality was located in Chinese Mahayana Buddhism. So he really calls it Chinese Buddhism. But instead of looking at theosophy, he argued that Immanuel Kant's philosophy was close to the ideas of the Buddha. With Liang, we are in the milieu of Chinese philosophers who try to reconcile Western philosophy with Chinese traditions. Perhaps more significant for our topic are intellectuals like the Taoist modernizer Chen Yingning, who lived from 1880 to 1969, who formed a circle of learned practitioners of Neidan, inner alchemy, in what came to be known as literati Taoism, Wenren Daojiao. The cultivation of the body was part of the, in his view, was part of the regeneration of Chinese national character. This is obviously very similar to the interest in Hatha Yoga and martial arts in India. Spirituality and martial arts are joined, an interest that is popularized in Shanghai movies of the 1920s and of course later in the Hong Kong movies that we have all watched. While much of Taoism was repressed as superstition, after the communist victory, the party made Chen Yingning head of the Taoist Association and promoted Qigong as the national science, with full support from party leaders and scientists. Again, one finds here a spiritual nationalism that is in full accordance with nationalist science. However, communist patronage stopped when the Qigong fever, with hundreds of millions of practitioners, started to threaten the monopoly of the party. It all was repressed after the Falun Gong challenged party authority in 1999 by demonstration in Beijing. Now you see them in Chinatown, sometimes, or many of them have fled to the US. And of course, it's still very popular in Hong Kong and in Taiwan and also in Vietnam. In this vacuum, there is a growing popularity of a seemingly apolitical yoga today among the Chinese middle classes in mainland China. Outside of this milieu of intellectuals, we find Buddhist reformist monks like Taishu, who lived between 1890 and 1947, who connected Buddhist cosmopolitanism with Chinese nationalism much in the same way as Anagarika Dhammapala from Sri Lanka had connected Buddhist cosmopolitanism with Sinhala nationalism. Dhammapala, who in his youth had been a theosophist, visited Japan and China after his own performance at the World Parliament of Religion in Chicago. His thinking deeply influenced Taishu, the founder of Engaged Buddhism, that is now dominant in Taiwan, and which was also taken up by the Vietnamese master Thich Nhat Hanh, the great leader of Vietnamese transnational Buddhism, about whom recently the African-American feminist Bell Hooks has written with great admiration. Nationalism was very much part of Buddhist monastic networks in China, but their great challenge was rather obviously their relation with Japanese Buddhism and of course the new imperialism of Japan. Taishu chose to work with the Kuomintang, with the nationalists, rather than with the communists, and he passed away in 1947, just before the defeat of the Kuomintang and the subsequent departure of many of the Buddhist monks he had inspired to Taiwan, where they have become dominant in the building up of what the sociologist Richard Matson has called democracy's dharma. So at the end, let me make a few concluding remarks. First, 19th century spirituality has both cosmopolitan and nationalist tendencies. It is born in the West out of a frustration with institutionalized churches. And in imperialist nations like Britain, France, and Holland, it connects socialist radicalism and anti-imperialism. In colonized nations like India and Vietnam, the spiritualist interest in the sacred traditions of the East is a much appreciated alternative to imperialist humiliation. Vivekananda plays a significant role in connecting a newly constructed Hindu spirituality with cosmopolitan spirituality. Second, Indians, especially after Vivekananda, have claimed spiritual leadership in the world. Political leaders like Gandhi and Nehru, and also artists like the Tagores, all in different ways, related their interventions to this new spirituality. Pan-Asianism, however, never really flies, because the historical pathways of the different Asian nations are so divergent. One can find easily references in early 20th century intellectual debates in China that refer to the spiritual preeminence of China. But the challenge in China is not to get rid of the British, like in India, but to counter the materialist and sometimes Christian attacks on Chinese traditions by other Chinese. Third, spirituality is a free-floating signifier that can be claimed by a wide range of movements, but in its nationalist incarnation, it excludes more than it includes. The most striking exclusion in India, and certainly in Bengal, is that of Sufi traditions, which were so much in conversation with Hindu traditions till the nationalist era. I'm not talking about a syncretism, a nice syncretism in the pre-colonial time or something, because monastic orders and networks were always very much in competition with each other. I'm referring to a shared universe that comes to be split up in Muslim and Hindu. I've always found it hard to understand why there is so little reference to Sufi spirituality in Bengali spiritual nationalism, while the majority of the population is clearly Muslim. And then fourth, finally, this narrowing down of an Indian universe that at the same time is opening up to the English-speaking world concerns not only the growing Hindu-Muslim antagonism, but also the occlusion of large parts of the Hindu religious landscape to which I was referring at the beginning of my talk. That kind of occlusion you can also find in China, where Confucianism as a moral philosophy is set apart from real existing practices at the local level of gaining moral guidance, such as spirit writing. In China, of course, there have been mass campaigns against popular religion as a form of superstition, and this we don't find in India. And then finally, today we know much more about Vivekananda and his milieu than about the Mahans, gurus and sadhus that are not in the nationalist spotlight. It is, in my view, still necessary to write a social history of 20th century Hinduism that gives spiritual nationalism a proper space, important, but circumscribed, limited. Thank you very much.